Okay, welcome everyone. This is my talk about WebGL, WebVR, and using the modern web technologies for data or info visualization. My name is Jaume Sánchez. This is my website, my GitHub profile, where there's lots of projects and libraries that you can check, and my Twitter profile, where I'm usually active, so if you want a question or something, I'm usually there. So, a bit of introduction about me. I've been developing software for a long time, many years. I used to do more like C, C++, boring software development, until there was the kind of the beginning of the, when Google released the autocomplete and started the Ajax Web 2.0 revolution. I thought like that's, it looks like a cool platform to work with. And then everything kind of got there with Canvas and Web Audio and WebGL. So I started working on web development. I got the chance of working for a few advertising agencies. Then I got hired as technical director. I work on many different projects in kind of rapid turnout. That's the youngest work, so you get to learn a lot of different things. And now I'm doing my own thing, developing tools and libraries for developers, mostly focused on performance for WebGL and WebVR developers. So some things that make part of my program. Yesterday you saw the Gravity website. It was a team effort. There's things like the Wilderness Downtown. I'll post this online. I might not show everything. One of the first things interesting that I worked in was this was one of, in 2012, one of the first WebGL games. It was for Google Maps. And it's basically one of those spin, how do you call them, like a labyrinth which you roll a marble across different. So this was a thing. It looks completely. Sorry. It was using not like actual information from Google Maps. Those were models, but it had rendering signal to Google Maps, and it was mixing CSS, DOM, and WebGL. It was like pretty new. So you could do lots of things. And one of the latest projects I worked in was the release website campaign for the HTC Vive. It's not online anymore, but there's the case study. So if you want to check it, it's got lots of like kind of intensive WebGL content. So all these are games in which you can play through the levels. You can play through the game with many. You can sync with your phone and use it as a controller, and it was pretty cool. It's not online anymore, but you probably can find videos. So that's like a bit of my work. And on my own time, I work on experiment different techniques, technologies on. Sorry, 1 second. I forgot to set the timer. And so like technology, so for instance, when the CSS 3D transforms first started, I created this prototype, which is like creating clouds with, this is just CSS layers, and it works like, it's been kind of very used for as background. It's just fake layers that simulate volumetric clouds. And you can change things and create like more stormy clouds, or you can even make it Michael Bay, and there's this explosion. So, then things like more proper, this is more recent, like proper what's called architecture visualization. So this is running in real time in the browser. It looks a bit more, you can see the lighting is accurate, the reflections are accurate. It's more like a story, and you can actually go interactive, and then you can see that it's this. So it's basically all real time in the browser, and it's pretty fast. It even runs on mobile. Looking for techniques for fast rendering compelling graphics on the web. Then more things like renderings. Then one of the things that I happened to do in back in the day with working on the Wilderness Downtown We used Google Maps tiles, the maps and the Street View maps tiles for the experience. So I started working like doing hacks with Street View. I created a library for like fetching the Street View tiles, which is what the person mentioned the other day. That's what's been able a lot of people to create hacks like the Sakura trees, the world underwater, and lots of stuff that break Google's terms. And they weren't very really happy about that. And our similar thing from 2011, picking the tiles from Google Maps, from the maps, and with a shader simulating at the Go, you can. This used to be tied to a weather API that they blocked, so it's not working anymore. But the whole thing, it's like, okay, let's look for exeter. So then it looks into it, centers the map and would look at the weather and tell you. So things like, okay, we can do interesting things with WebGL. It was a few years ago. So before I start, I want to apologize on behalf of most things that as kind of graphics or creative coders, as we are sometimes called, we disregard for even like for technical reasons or for just motivation. So WebGL graphics don't usually have accessibility because it's basically a flat canvas with context on it. So there's nothing to actually make accessible. Typography is sometimes a very mistreated field on 3D graphics for several technical reasons, and because it's actually hard. So they're usually really, really bad. Mobile sometimes is disregarded because it's not a very powerful platform, and it requires a lot of work to get properly working, even though some, like nowadays, the mobile phones are getting really, really fast. Also, responsiveness is not the best of, like the, all these media queries, all these nice technologies don't really exist on 3D graphics or WebGL rendering, so we have to make it. So there's no standard, so some people follow it, some people don't. And yeah, so the declarative languages, you've seen A-Frame, which is a very nice approach to declarative markup for creating scenes, but usually most of these graphics are like created with insanely large chunks of JavaScript. So, yeah. Anyway, the mantra of this, as has been said, just because we can doesn't mean we should. And as like quoting just prior scientists were so preoccupied with whether or not they could that they even stop to think if they should, which makes it sound like very cool, like very like dudes that know what we're doing, but in the end we're basically kind of like this the whole time. So yeah, there's no roadmap. There's no some people have worked on specific papers and have found ways of doing things, but most of the time you're trying to figure it out as you go. Anyway. So, first part about data processing, real-time graphics, or the reality and other web technologies that you can use today to a certain extent, more or less support, or tools of addition. I usually put this image to signify that it's there's like heavy maths, heavy algebra, heavy concepts. I've stripped everything from this tradition that I thought it was. It's not patronizing, it's just because it doesn't really make sense to talk about cross vectors and cross product and things like that. But yeah, it's there, so I'll try to keep it light. So, nowadays, for most of what's been explained about how to display data on the browser, as you've seen, it's running on the server side. It's either Python or some structure, like complex cloud structure, that prepares everything, and then the browser just displays, just does, not a symbol, but like a very basic treatment of information. There's actually, JavaScript has improved a lot on handling of data. There's the ES5, which is kind of what already all browsers support. The arrays, the elements in which you put data in, have lots of interesting methods that you can use. So for instance, the most interesting ones are the first three, which lets you run to an array, like for instance for each, that lets you execute some operation on each element of an array. What you usually do as a for loop or a while loop, now you can do it more functionally and chain different operations. So you can chain a lot of filtering or transforming or adapting operations. You can map reduce, if you are familiar with that concept. Mapping is basically taking an array, performing some kind of transformation, and you get a new array, and reduce the start rate in the frozen version that will give you an aggregate. That's what companies like Google use for their search engine and for many calculations. And you can run this on the browser. Filter, you can get an array, provide a function that defines what can be filtered, you get in return a filter array. Every will tell you if on the set that you're evaluating there's something that matches that. So you could have a million values and say, is any of this blue? Is any of this over this latitude? You know? And it will say yes. And some, like we would say that if all of them, then some would tell you at least one of them. ES6 arrays are like a progression on this. This is more experimental. Some browsers do support this, some browsers still don't. So use at your own risk. You can build arrays from arrays, you can find stuff on arrays, you can pre-fill it with session operations. And the beauty of this is that all these methods are create iterators, create iterable. I can never say that word in out loud. How do you say it? Iterable collections or simple collection. So you can start chaining everything, and it's like a beautiful queue of operations that provide you with something that you can then represent. You also have map and set, which if you're aware of that, it's like you usually know use associative arrays. Map is a more powerful concept, as like of key value. Set is a collection of values. And weak map and weak set are very interesting because they don't link to the value that you're using as a key, so you can delete it without creating a memory view. They're on top of that, like, very clever people are doing this. You can use it because it's really nice. More advanced stuff if you're into scientific visualizations, things like that. Types arrays, it's like your regular array, but it uses pure data formats like you would use in using a compiled language. Integers, float 32. If you can run with that, if your data can be expressed in types arrays, it's insanely faster than regular arrays. You've got the single instruction, multiple data, new operations that will be able to let you help, like, will let you use up to 128 bits of operations. It's insanely fast, still very experimental. This is going progressively into the future. GPGPU, it's a technology, it's an API. What's the API? To use the GPU, like your graphics card, for doing vastly parallel computation. And then we get to AsimJS and WebAssembly, which your pages will be delivered in bytecode, and that's hence the nuclear explosions, because this is basically this is what you get. You know, start. So keep in mind that you can use a lot of methods which work, which are simple to understand and use to process data on the browser. So download is one thing. Once you get your data set, you can start working with that, and it's faster. So, what do we know about real-time graphics on the web? From many years, we've had DOM and CSS, and it's been progressing with the CSS2, CSS3, CSS3 specifications. You're familiar with transitions, you're familiar with animations with keyframe. Some properties nowadays on the browser are hardware accelerated, which means that are very cheap, mostly transforms like translating, scaling, rotating, and opacity changes. There's work on the Web Animations API, which will help you, will let you do more complex animations and control them from JavaScript. And there's the Houdini project, which is a name for providing JavaScript access to the CSS engine. So you can do lots of things that nowadays might be frustrating because the browser is not yet supporting. You might be able to code them. SVG, it's been talked a lot about. There's very nice libraries for visualization and for managing like the free Appel, Snap. We're still waiting on the GPU accelerated path rendering, which would be the thing that would make SVGs really fast in the browser, but there's no quorum on how should it be, how should progress, how should be implemented. You know Canvas 2D? This is pretty standard too. It's a way of getting an element which you can draw lines, arcs, draw images, use text, transforms, complex operations like blending, and also direct pixel manipulation, which is interesting. So it's a step up in what you can do with graphics. And then we get 3D Canvas WebGL. It's the WebGL rendering context object. It's the definition of WebGL, the JavaScript API for rendering interactive 3D computer graphics, 2D graphics within any compatible web browser for the use of plugins. The key here being plugins. We used to draw more complex stuff with Flash. Now the browsers can do it, and you can actually code that in a dynamic language like a JavaScript. It used to be not very broadly distributed, and now every phone, every browser has WebGL support, so it's a very reasonable option. So, quick overview about WebGL so you understand more or less how it works. This is probably the most complex stuff we learned about. You've got the concept of buffers. A buffer is an object that stores data. So it would be where you place the points that make up your shapes, the definition that makes up the paths. That's where you put all of them. And those are typed arrays, as we said. It's a very effective data representation. You've got textures, which are not just images, but are also state and information about that image. How it should be sampled, how it should be represented. Does it have any hidden properties? Then you have programs, and programs is actually what GPU uses to take that data and put it on screen. So it's something that you can code that will be used and executed and will represent your data on screen. So you're used to having operations on your platform that will do that, and with WebGL you basically have to do it. You can reuse code, you can find shaders, you can find programs and libraries, but it has to be done. The browser won't do it for you. It's a very basic API. Shaders are the actual program. I know it's difficult to understand program and then program inside program, but basically to draw something, you have two programs, which one tells how the shape is, the other tells how the color and the texture is. With those are shaders. They are coded in GLSL, so you're not using JavaScript anymore in there. You're not using HTML, you're not using CSS, you're using GLSL. Fairly simple language, but it's more C-like. And frame buffers, which are basically targets to which you can render information. So basically, you also could be a frame buffer, or you could render to a frame buffer and use it as a texture and do something with it until you get it to screen or not. So, summing up, buffers define objects, which you would call meshes, and they're rendered by programs that use shaders and textures, and they write to a frame buffer. That's the most simple thing I can explain about how WebGL works. But you don't really have to use it. I mean, you can use it, and it's probably really effective, but it's a very long piece of code. So you've got libraries that help you, like Free.js, which A-Frame is built on top. You've got Pixie.js, which it's more oriented to 2D graphics, so it will be more like your canvas, but it's accelerated. Rigo, it's a new one that's more aiming for a more functional definition of your scene. 2.js, also for more 2D operations. So, just to understand, this is what we're saying about typed arrays. This will enable the WebGL to get running. And it's something that is helped, and also data, because this is basically how you have memory. This is a chunk of memory of 16 bytes. And then from there, you can read it as single chars, as flow 32, it can be float point, it can be a number from 1 to from 0 to 255. So this is how you make things effective. This is how you make things fast. So this is right now. The future is OpenGL, is WebGL 2. So we're based on OpenGL 3.0. We will get to the point of what mobile phones are right now. We've got transport feedback and multi-render targets and 3D texture synthesis, multi-sample buffers, and yeah, I know, I lost you again. But it will be really good. It will be really good for the future. But right now, using libraries, you're pretty good to go. Anyhow, so we get to virtual reality on the web, and we've got a really, really good introduction to what's right now about creating content, but the on-demand technology. If I can explain a bit how it went when we started with VR in the web, the actual concept of web VR, we were using stereo rendering, so basically drawing on a canvas with these methods I've explained. Using the device orientation, what your phone knows how it's looking, how it's facing, how it's rotating. And we were able to create 3D scenes for virtual reality with CSS DOM in Canvas. So it was more like you could actually write a page with CSS 3D transforms and you could pass it to the to what in the end, back then was the DK1, the first prototype of Oculus, using something that was called Oculus Bridge, which was, there wasn't even an API on JavaScript. It was using a service that was running and you could ask from JavaScript what's the position of the HMD. This is the edge, the heads mounted display. So then it improved, we got a specification of WebVR. It was decided that you should use WebGL to render content because that was what made sense. It kind of exploded with the DK2, we got the HTC Vive, the Oculus Rift, Gear VR, which is this this kind of visor for your Samsung phone. It's like an advanced cardboard, Google cardboard. There was an effort to get a WebVR polyfill, which would make seamlessly work all the different approaches to VR in the different devices, because of course this is very different from the cardboard. And you mainly want to be able to work with the same API, same way that if you draw on a canvas, you know that the canvas should more or less look the same on a phone, Safari, on Windows. And from there, 3JS, for instance, started adding lots of modules, so you could work with VR, create render in stereo. Automatically, things like A-Frame can benefit from that, and the community itself can benefit. And now we are on the WebVR 1.1 specification, which defines how to work with modern headsets. There's gamepad extensions, API that serves to handle these controllers, because this is mostly what used to be considered a gamepad, like a console gamepad, but it's not anymore. Now it's own thing. It's got positional tracking, rotational tracking. In the future, we have things like the Carmel browser by Oculus, by Facebook, React VR, which will be similar to A-Frame. Mobile VR has to, is still to really explode. It's an option, but it's still not being broadly used, as we can see, because we ran a few cardboards and nobody really had a phone or, you know. It's technically possible, it's just not broadly adopted. And augmented reality. In reality, right now the problem is that phones usually just have one camera if you want stereo vision. So we need phones with two cameras, at least two cameras. Okay, more web technologies, and I'm basically with this part. We've got Promises, which lets you work with asynchronous operations like JavaScript does, so you are not blocking and you can much more improve your flow. You've got the old XML HTTP request, and now the new specification, which is called Fetch, to getting assets from the network, from the network connection. We've got WebRTC peer connection to create point-to-point connection. I think, Ravin, that you were using WebRTC for the connection with phones. You can use data channels, you can use get user media to access the microphone and camera. There's workers if you want to make parallel work. There's the speech API. There's web audio to create sound, to create 3D spatial sound. There's web MIDI if you want to work with MIDI protocol. And of course, all the integrations with the many, many services out there that are based on web technologies. So let's get to actual something practical rendering. Okay, so what I'm going to show you is 2 years ago, there was the global international migrations, the global flow of people. I don't know if you remember this one. Okay, so this is a really nice graph, this is a really nice representation. And back then I thought we should be able, I mean, it would be interesting to see it in WebGL, maybe in 3D. 2 years ago when I made it, there was a DK2, but it's changed completely, so what I did, it doesn't work anymore. So this is the new version. And let's see if we can make it work. Okay. Yeah, actually, I should just use it there. Let's see. So for instance, one of the things I'm working on is the WebVR emulator extension, which is I don't have a Vive with me, but I can use DevTools to kind of simulate that I'm inside the VR, you know. So if you're developing, for instance, I could simulate this. So this is more or less a map Earth. Oh, it looks really dark. Anyway. So yeah, let me show you in there. A second. I'm gonna have to type it. So for WebVR, there's right now you need to download the Chromium WebVR build or Firefox Nightly. Those are the two browsers that support right now the This is the double jump of my demos. Okay, it's loading. Sorry.
It's super weird. Parallax error.
Yeah, completely. It's loading. Okay, there we are. Okay. You should be seeing what I'm seeing. Okay. Hopefully. Yes. Okay. Second. So I'm going to this. Okay, so I start the controller. Okay, you see the controller?
Yeah.
Okay. Usually the station should be way up, so they look down on the scene, but the tripods are short, so I'm not worth tracking. Okay, so you can see that this is the world, and now I realize that you don't see the chaperone, but I'm seeing a protection barrier that tells me where the limits of my space are, of my vertical space, but it's not aligned right now with this space. It's aligned with the space we created yesterday, so I don't want to move a lot. But okay, so. I can, for instance, point at places and shoot, and then select something. And what I'm doing here is drawing the same flows I use on the 2D, but it's basically on 3D. So the idea is that you can explore physically. You know, you can get to Germany. I know you're seeing it.
Yes.
Yeah. Because if not, then it's happening at every time, but you're not seeing anything. So same thing, like, for instance, if you want to check the United Kingdom. And you see like how things go to Australia, which is down there, and I could move to Australia or check this small outflow to Ireland or this much larger flow out to Spain. I guess you can see, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's basically the thing. And then most of the stuff, like the data, it's loaded from the original CSV from the project. And it's being processed in this is so small. You know why sometimes you don't see any flow? I'm gonna show you why. It's because this. So that's the Mexico migration to the States, and it's like if that thickness normalizes everything else. So sometimes it's just too small. So for instance, you can see that this line here, it's actually almost 20,000 people, but of course that's almost 2 million, you know. So yeah, that's basically the idea. And then you can actually start like exploring things. That's the thing. It's we've talked previously about the removing the interactivity from the user. But in this case, maybe exploring data physically makes sense, you know? So, if I lose tracking, it's gonna start spinning, so. Okay, so. So, rendering, or what's called putting stuff on screen, I'm gonna show you like a really quick demo. One is points, okay? Because one of the basics of visualization. So this, for instance, it's a point cloud. Okay, I took a data set CSV dataset and I'm filtering it, adapting it, summarizing it, using a conversion from longitude to 3D coordinates and put it in as a point cloud. And I'm going to show you more or less. It's not about the code. It's more or less about how do you approach this. So, for instance, this English, okay? So, can you see? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So, these are the different functions. So, there's really short functions that do specific things. Okay. So, for instance, when we do the init, I'm calling load file and I'm getting the CSV. And your load file function does a fetch. Okay. Fetches the file from the file system, returns a promise that when it's resolved, which means when it's done, because the fetch can take seconds or hours or milliseconds, it takes the text and then it calls a parsing method of CSV. All of these methods can be asynchronous, and this way, with chaining them, you can actually forget, not wait for something to done, and it's not blocked. So, first the CSV, and when I get it back, I call my filter data, which will remove things that are badly informed. I call it to turn to structure, which I get the array, because it gets into array. I turn it into an actual object, so it's here, like this one. So turn to structure gets a data, which is an array, and for each, I run a map, where I get each element, and return a new structure that turns different columns and specific names. Name, latitude, longitude, and I create an object position. So this is what it runs through almost 300,000 of entries. And then after that, I can locate them, so it means turning the latitude longitude into 3D coordinates. I can init the scene, which is the 3D environment. I can init the point scene, the line scene, cube scene, attach the handlers, and start rendering. So this is like a sequence of commands in a synchronous fashion. Usually you do it in a row. This allows you to do things that might take longer or go to work there, do it in parallel, and come back. So, for instance, the point scene, like how do I get all these points? You know, you create a points geometry, which is this kind of holder of buffer that will keep your vertices. Each point will be a vertex. It's a 3D position, and you run through the entry, so through every city that I have. And allocating that tight array, you remember that buffer that was like cells. I'm gonna put the x, y, z, x, y, z, x, y, z, x, y, z. I'm gonna add it to the geometry as a position. So then when I run my program, I know that I'll have a position, which will be a 3D vector of where the point is. And then I create a points material. This is default 3JS, so you don't have to worry about it. So with some attributes like size, I want it to be smaller in the distance, sometimes you want that, sometimes you don't. Transparent, because I might change the opacity, and create a mesh, which is all my points from point geometry drawn in this material. I hide it for the time being, because I want to change it with a click, and basically add it to the scene. So when I call render of the scene, it will be there. So this is it. When I toggle points, I can show it or hide it, and there's a large amount of. And for instance, this is more like coding, but you can actually get points and say the material, I want the opacity to be 0.1. It's much more transparent, or like 0.5. I think you can even go like color equals not color, but set RGB, that's one. So now it's pink, you know? So that is telling the program that it's running this rendering. Instead of the white color, use the pink color. So if you think about it, you have that representation of, for instance, your SVG, which have an attribute that it's fill style, or stroke style, or the CSS, stroke, which is the color, and then this SVG rendering would know how to draw lines with that parameter. So this is basically the same thing, much lower level. So this is points. Same thing with lines, if it works, okay. So this is lines, and they're as long as the length of the name of the city, for instance. You know, I could tell you a better data set, but you can imagine that the New York taxi, the cab drives and everything can be used. Same thing with this, you've got a material, you can change the opacity, and then it looks a bit more universal features. So things like that. There's literally, in this case, there's this many, 291,936 elements. So twice that for in vertices for lines. How do we do these lines? It's very similar to the points. It's just that instead of creating one vertex per point, we're adding two. One is the original, it's where the city is, and the other one is a bit outwards based on the length of the line. And then we tell the system, you're gonna draw every two vertices is gonna be a line. Line, 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 and it does it in parallel in milliseconds or nanoseconds. So you've got points, you've got lines, and now you can also show meshes. So this is the same thing, but it looks like points, but it's actually, you can see it, it's small cubes. Can you see it?
Yeah.
So of course, I mean, it's pretty insane to have this many cubes, but it could be graph bar, it could be something that's related. You wouldn't usually draw that many cubes, but you can. And you can actually draw everything at the same time, you know, and still like this. This is still running on this GPU, which is a MacBook Pro, which is it's a good GPU, but it's not an amazing GPU. So this would be this would be more or less how you do things. Okay. How are you doing? Is this too much? Is it okay? Any questions so far? No? Okay. So, shaders. Last kind of very technical thing. This is probably something that you're okay. So just so you understand one thing about GPU, because that usually makes a whole difference. This is a set of vertices connected by a set of lines which define triangles. And triangles is the basic for drawing meshes, drawing geometries in the GPU. So the same way you've seen that I've been adding points to a structure and then rendering that, this is also random points added and drawn. But you're seeing them in wireframe. Why is it important? Because the vertex shader, that program that tells how to transform things, which basically responsible to when I rotate the camera, this changes, and when I change the perspective, it goes away. The vertex shader only calculates on those vertices. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There's actually more, but those 9 points, it's what's calculated. The rest of the information, so each vertex has a position information, and as you can see, a color information. The rest of the information, it's automatically linearly interpolated by the GPU. So those lines you see between each point, each vertex, those kind of gradients, you don't have to do anything. Just for instance, there's green here, and there's red here. All these colors in between, and if they don't have to be colors, it can be normals, it can be height, it can be intensity, it can be any value that you need to use, the GPU automatically is creating this linear gradient. And it's creating these intermediate points. So you don't actually have to do anything. Just tell the fragment shader how you want to use that information to draw each individual pixel, but you don't have to create it. So then when you are using that, not only does the, it uses the, seeing children. Okay. So beyond the wireframe, the actual solid rendering, it does the same thing but across the whole triangle. So all these interpolated values automatically taken care of the GPU in parallel. And that's the biggest, the big power of GPUs. But all the information, if you think about it, you started from 9 points and actually you're like filling the whole screen with values, and that you don't have to actually calculate. You just have to address the minimum expression, which is vertices, and how to draw fragments or pixels. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So, chapter 3, return events of the rendering. Good. So we have this visualization. So how to apply the same thing about points, lines, meshes, fragment shaders, vertex shaders, this. So first, getting the data. In this case, for this specific visualization, as I said, there's a CSV that I got from the GitHub repo of the project. I get it. You can keep any kind of format that you can write. There's a lot of formats. You can use from file, you can use from network request, you can use from local storage, so you can store data on the browser and use it at a later date. You read the file, there's many ways, you parse the file, do whatever you want with it. And in this case, for the map, like the, okay, so all the information, all this borders information, this is actually an SVG from Wikipedia. So I took the SVG from Wikipedia, I parsed the line information, and I created a line geometry, as you've seen, and I'm drawing that. And I have one for the whole planet and one for each individual country, so I can extrude it. I could use the same thing, and probably Evan will show you a solid version, but I wanted to keep it like real simple, because usually when you have a solid thing, then it's more like a model, you have a 3D model. But this, all this information, all this complexity, comes from a single SVG, I think it's like 58K. So compared to the actual model, which would be several megabytes, it's quite good. So you can still use the same assets that you would usually use, you just have to process them in a different way. The background image, it's actually it's the bathymetry project from Asia. So yeah, using the SVG to convert to geometry, there used to be an API from the browser that would let you actually access all the different segments on an SVG. They deprecated it, but there's a polyfill, so check it out if you want. There's an article, someone asked about SVG optimization. I have an article linked here about SVG optimization, like massively, like all the different techniques of like ordering attributes and how to produce necessary characters, so check it out. And then of course you can load textures and models, so you can probably work with 3D artists and import their assets. So when we have the data, we set up the render with Vue.js, which is very simple. There's lots of examples on the documentation. Then you define the scene via what's called a scene graph, and it's basically adding your stuff where you think it makes sense. So in this case, for instance, I have a backdrop globe, then I have all my geometry of borders, and then I have the labels, and then I have the flow lines. I have it like that because if I want to hide something, I can change it. Everything is, for instance, inside a whole scene, which I can scale accordingly, which makes sense because, for instance, in this case, this is a few meters wide, and then I cannot walk from end to end of the globe. But if I wanted to make a much bigger installation, I could change the scale. Because that's the thing, when you're here, I mean, what you're seeing might seem like the whole world, but when you're using the glasses, it's very much like 3 meters in diameter or something like that. So you add everything, camera slides, everything that is going to be used for rendering, what's called that, and then the animate render loop. You just draw constantly. These computers run at 60 frames per second. Virtual reality runs at 90 frames per second, twice. So you've got 11 milliseconds most to draw twice your scene. 11 milliseconds, which is insane. Set your core. You get to do it. So on that loop, you update all your information, all your animations, all your camera positions, reading from paths, easing through mathematical equations, reading from the WebRTC connection. You draw it, and when you have it, you might polish it or embellish it with post-processing, which we don't have here because it's usually you don't put post-processing on the app because it's already kind of hard to see. Rendering considerations, I've already explained vertex shader, how it relates to SVG and CS transforms, fragment shader, how it relates to styling. Everything that you draw one single object or you change the way it's drawn, it's called a state change. Because you're basically telling the GPU to leave what it's doing, take in another set, put it there, continue drawing. It's like asking people to change pens and rulers constantly. So that's called every change of state related to a draw pool. And you draw something, it adds a lot. So for instance, the way of drawing, if you had to draw 300,000 points one by one, it would be absurdly slow on human imagination view. So what we're doing is we're putting everything in one single operation and saying draw 300,000 points at the same time. And that's what makes some things much faster and some things much slower. So considering this, consider that you usually would be drawing in info visualization different elements. You have to group them and draw them in a specific sensible pattern. So first all your meshes which are solid with this color, then these points which are different color and things like that. Usually your framework like 3JS will take care of that. But you will need extra, it might need extra help telling what to group, what to merge. So interacting with data, how are we doing? Thank you very much. Okay. So different models of interaction. Of course you've seen that most of the examples like Rabimba showed it, they work with your mouse. You might want to make with mouse, with your phone. You might want to work with the controller. So you have to think that, for instance, the cardboard doesn't actually have a button. I mean, it doesn't have a button, but it doesn't really have a button. The second generation has a button. So you have to activate things by looking at them, waiting a few seconds, or doing something different, or maybe doing voice enabled. There's many ways, but you have to think about that. You might not have to care. You might have a very restricted use case, and then you don't have to do that, but if you want to reach the maximum audience, then you have to consider all those possibilities. Then one thing that you need to do for interaction, like interacting with data, it's actually knowing what's being interacted with. So you're very well accustomed to having the add event listener, mouse move, mouse in, mouse out, click. All that doesn't exist on WebGL. You have to build it, you have to make it. And since there's no common structure for how to define objects, because you can define them any way you want, as you've seen, it's just strings of like arrays of numbers, you have to find some way. Usually what it's done is there's an array, there's a mathematical array that checks for intersection against the geometry. But if, for instance, you have 300,000 elements, or you have the whole world, it might not be practical. So I'll tell you later in the next slide how I did this for this one. So once you've identified the object with selection, you have to enable your animations, your storytelling, what happens, and that's pure JavaScript. That's the same as once you had the on-click event. One important thing, frame rate independent animations. That means that you usually don't use, you don't increment things with summing. You have to make them based on time. Because if it runs a bit slow, but it runs a bit fast, your animations will change. So always make them based on time, not based on increments. So this is the same scene, but how the controller is seeing it. So I'm taking the SVG, the original SVG, the same I'm using for the borders, and I'm drawing on a canvas, on a texture, each country with a different level of red. 0 to 255. Unfortunately, there's not more than 256 countries in the world, I think. Yeah, 233, I think. So there's an offline rendering of the same scene, and I check for a point where this is pointing at. I read that color, and I know from the red number, the amount of red, what country is being selected. That doesn't make any sense, but as I said, we make things as we go. You know, we don't have, I mean, internally, maybe some libraries do that, but that's how we do it. And it's fast. I mean, the red pixels, it's not that as fast, but it works. So things like that. There's ways of optimizing this, but the important thing is that this comes from the same SVG that builds the geometry. So again, on that fast. And then finish this exporting and sharing data, which is of course one of the strengths of the web. There's many ways of doing this. So once you have this online and people can reach it, and you can share the link normally using social media, Twitter, Facebook, you might want to share the state in which things are, not like from the beginning. So how do you provide deep link, how you encode state on what you're saying? You can use a big hash encoding everything like Google Maps does. You can have server-side persistence providing, if you have this is all browser-side, I don't have any server running, just the hosting. But if you have a server, you might provide a token that defines the state, like it's looking this way, this is selected. There's a trick that I've been used previously. It's I encode all the state in an image, in a PNG image, and I upload it to Imgur. So they make my server. I don't have to spend the money on a server. So I can ask for the PNG afterwards, and I have everything encoded on the data. Someday they might change it and it will break. And for instance, you have to decide if it's based on user action, so I want to share the state, or every time I change something on the visualization, everything changes and I can share it by copying the URL or sharing. You can export images like a proper snapshot using the Canvas to data URL, which will, even if it's WebGL, you have to enable a drawing buffer, but you can export a PNG, a JPEG, or in some versions, a WebP. Or you can use server-side rendering if you're up for it. I've never seen anyone really pulling that, but it's an option. And if you want to export video, you can use the Video Recorder API together with the Canvas capture stream that will capture everything you're running and provide you, like give you a blog video in the end, or use a library I made that is called C-Capture that is for this purpose. So you can capture in WebM, in separate images, or many other options. You can stream to a server too. Okay, these are basically notes I've taken during these conversations. There's notes on this, notes on WebGL, notes on WebVR, but there was time. But yeah, I think we made it on time. Mm-hmm. We survived, so great. These are some links with main properties. I like to say two things, now let's say this. If you have to check something, check ShaderToy. Are you familiar with ShaderToy?
Yeah.
Okay, ShaderToy it's basically a website in which you can create. This is just the geometry is two triangles. It's actually one, but and everything is drawn on the fragment shader. All these operations have no geometry, no information, no models, and there's an insane amount of stuff going on here. And lots of clever people are using it to investigate and explore graphics for many new things. So it's really an interesting place to investigate and learn things. That's one thing. This is very kind of hardcore, really, really, really clever people. And then there's Sketchfab, which is a service which lets you upload your model, 3D model, and share it online. So if you have data and want to share it, you can publish it here, and it's got a really nice renderer. And it's got VR support. So out of the box, you can share your visualization or model or something that you've created. You can upload it here. It works beautifully, as you can see. It looks amazing. And it's got the VR version, which again, I can show you from my extension. So something like this, you would see it will work on Cardboard, it would work across the platform. It's a really interesting delivery platform in case you don't want to go there. So that's it. Again, these are my credentials on the internet. The talk is published on that link. You go to talk, it's there. And it's linked to the slides, to the GitHub repo with the code if you want. And that's it. If you have any questions, it's mine.